So, okay, let's move in there. My name is Marten, you already introduced me. Who has heard about this guy, Ray Kurzweil? You got it. Anybody else? No, okay, good. Ray Kurzweil is a, basically, again, one of these multi-talents. He is an entrepreneur. He is actually the inventor of the CCD scanner, the flatbed scanner that we all know. He also has written numerous books on different technology topics. He has drafted out future predictions in the end of the 80s, beginning of the 90s. He saw basically the internet coming, he saw Google coming, he predicted Google 12 years earlier. And interesting is that now he actually works for Google. And he leads the what's that department? I don't know exactly. It's like the engineering far think ahead kind of department. On a project or on projects where they try to simulate the human brain within Google. So he wrote a book that is called Singularity is Near. And if anything that I say in this talk here interests you guys, get back to that book and maybe get more information about it. So what is all of that about? We basically start with the fact that we have a big difference between exponential and linear growth, right? We know linear growth from the way how we humans think. We know exponential growth from how basically digital growth goes these days, right? So we had to wait a couple of million years for the first technology wheel get invented, then we had to wait a couple of thousand years for the next technology step and so on, until we are today where we basically only have a couple of minutes mainly until the next breakthrough is coming through. That is why we're talking about the, when we talk about digital, we always talk about exponential growth, while a little bit of the problem is that the human brain is not really made for that. Something like, imagine for example you have a bird flying, you want to shoot the bird. We can do that pretty well, like we can aim a little bit ahead so that we hit the bird, but if the bird is kind of like flying, accelerating or decreasing its speed, it's very difficult for us. If the bird would fly in an exponential speed, then, or in an exponential increase, it's very difficult for us to hit the bird. And that's why we humans always tend to kind of think that technology will evolve slower than it actually does, especially on digital revolutions. So what does that mean for the human? The first thing that I would like to talk about is not, as I said already before, I don't want to talk about, you know, like actual technology that we hold in our hand or that we do. I want to see what does that mean for the human, right? So the first thing that is that will kind of like disrupt our life, I always have a little timeline up there. So this is like the early 20s, we're talking about like the next five to 10 years. And during that time, we're going to have nanobots basically doing operations on cell level inside our bodies. This is a technology that's already there. We don't need to far-fetch this, like it's something that we're working on that's kind of like in progress as we speak. What we do there is we are, you all know it's a virus, right? So what a virus does is it invades the body and actually goes into the cell, and then it replaces, it cuts out part of the cell DNA and replaces it with its own DNA, with the virus hostile DNA, and replaces it inside. So what we do with nanotechnology at the moment is the same thing. We basically take a virus, we take the bad part of the bad DNA out of the virus, we take our DNA that we want to go into the cell, into the virus, and then we release it on the body, and then the virus is putting our DNA into the cell. So we can actually do all kinds of medical treatments based on that at the moment. In the future, we probably gonna go to a point where we can replace these little viruses with some kind of bots. So that would be kind of like a robot kind of thing that we can maneuver around and basically be steered from the outside or from itself. And then do basically real-time DNA adjustments on the human cell. So this is something which is groundbreaking. Why is it groundbreaking? Because if we understand how medical was always working is here, like we the next disease comes out, we always have a lot of trial and error until we figure out a way to get there, right? Now, what we, and that is because we basically do it manually. What we do with this here is we basically, we repair on DNA level. And DNA, we basically, it's binary. Binary is on and off, right? But DNA has four, so it's kind of similar concept. So what we do is we digitalize medicine. So in that sense, we bring medicine from that chart over into this chart. So that means we had like a linear growth here, but at some we are now at this point where basically the exponential growth chart is going to hit through the linear growth and going to grow in an exponential chart way. And that makes it quite interesting for our time today. So what we basically do is we cut and paste DNA and put it into the cells that we need. So we deliver it exactly where we need to have it. And that means that we can do any kind of medical operations in a non-invasive way on the human body, on the living human body. And that is a technology that we basically already have. We need to make it marketable. So early 20s, we are roughly in that level. So this is basically how the gene therapy works, right? So I don't go too much into that. Like we're taking a virus that basically, where we put the DNA inside, we bring it inside, and it delivers it to the cell. So there, another application there is that we do, another thing that we are already doing is we're working with stem cells. Our stem cells are these kind of cells that are like the original cell that can develop into any kind of body cell, like become an eye or an arm or a liver or something like that. And what we do is we use these stem cells to actually extract them out of an existing body and then grow something that we need to be replaced in that body. Let's say, for example, you have a bad liver, you need a new liver, you can use stem cells to actually grow a liver outside of your body and then replace that one with your new liver inside your body. So, it's a bit spooky, but because thinking about having like a third arm or something, other body application extended, it's a little bit far-fetched. But with these technologies, we actually can heal already quite a lot of physical medical problems that we have today. So that brings us basically to the next step that is coming in the early 30s, right? So 15 years from now, roughly. how does the human 2.0 actually look like?
We can go back.
No, doesn't matter. It's just a picture. So, did you get what? How to say that? Rest pyrocytes. Okay. So, what do they do? Rest pyrocytes are basically also small little nanobots. So they are not. They are probably some kind of mix between technical, like mechanical and organic parts. And they will swim with our blood, and they're actually replacing the red blood cells. So what that means is the red blood cells in our body are responsible for deploy the oxygen from our lung to our body and into all the muscles. So now if we can transport oxygen with red pyrocytes, then that means that we can bring the oxygen inside our body to all the places without actually utilizing the lung, or just utilizing the lung a lot more efficient. So that, for example, with one breath, I'm a free diver, right? So I take one breath and I dive like really deep under the ocean. With that way, everybody can do it. And you can do like for example, you need to make a very fast sprint. You need a lot of oxygen into your muscles. You can deliver that very quickly with that, right? At the same time, these respirocytes also will bring the CO2 back out of the system, right? So that's basically what they. So we basically inventing like. We're inventing new red blood cells and replacing them with digital ones, basically. The second thing that we're going to do is we're going to have feeding nanobots. So they basically do, they bring nutrition, energy, and so on into our body parts. So that would basically replace the whole digestive tract that we have. So stomach and all the things that we have here. Which is quite an interesting idea to kind of living in the body 2.0, and you don't need your lung and you don't need your stomach anymore. But that's basically what we have. Going to look for there. Then we have elimination nanobots, which are basically the garbage man of our body. So that's also what the blood is doing at the moment, right? We wash out all the bad thing and then we get it out. That's what also nanobots can do. So they can detoxin us in a lot more efficient way in the future than our body can do that ourselves. So that's the body 2.0, which still relatively looks like the body that we have today, just that probably inside we have a lot more space if we want to remove these organs that we might not need anymore. So we could be creative of what we want to put in or not. These are all things that we would love to discuss with you guys. But yeah, that's body 2.0. And what does that lead us to? Is really longevity, right? What happens if we don't get sick anymore, if we don't get old anymore, because we can renew ourselves on the fly, we can renew our DNA in the living cell, right? So we don't get old, we don't get sick, we don't actually really need to die. If, if I don't go around and shoot anybody here, there's no real reason for you guys to die anymore. So it's quite interesting, because if we're looking at that time point there, then most of the people in this room are still going to be alive, right? So it might really be that our parents may be the last generation on Earth human that actually still need to die. So what does that mean for us humans, right? If we are if we are kind of like in a kind of immortal body, that we, you know, that the only reason why we feel time is because one day time will end when we die, right? But if we theoretically don't die anymore, what does time mean to us? Why does David need to build this company as quick as possible if he has basically forever time, right? So the concept of it is something that is very difficult for the human brain to grasp, but eventually it will still fall in our lifetime. Then there's another interesting thing that will happen during the same time, and that is basically that imagine you have a little kid in Africa, right? And that little kid in Africa that gets very bad disease, like some kind of new virus comes out that we have never seen on this planet, right? And that potentially even has the power to wipe out the whole planet in a giant pandemic, right? So that little kid has these nanobots inside that are like the little doctor, right? And the little doctors, they can't really cope with the problem because the virus is actually even killing like what all these electronic doctors, let's say. So then what's going to happen is by that time we will have not only a network of all these little doctors in our body talking to each other, they will also talk to the internet. And with that, they will talk to any other person in the world and any other person's little doctors, right? So we're basically going to have a giant cloud of doctors that can compute that kind of problem. And we could even put in capable AI on there that could solve a problem. And whatever needs to be solved can be solved with DNA therapy, right? Because it's all, any kind of virus would be just consist out of DNA, which is four different chunks of information. And we could basically then compute the problem in the cloud, then download the solution into the little kid in Africa and tell the bots what to do, right? So basically, we fight new diseases faster than they can actually appear, right? Which is exactly what the exponential growth curve says. So that's what's going to happen during the same time. And then we will have this kind of like brain connection. So what we do right now is we still use our phones, right? But we actually connect our brains to the cloud using the phone, right? So if I want to know, if I have a question, I ask my phone, and the phone asks the clouds, and the clouds get it back. And so I have this information available, but I still need to go through my phone. So that is not going to be the future. The future is going to be that we have these little nanobots not only repairing our body, we're also going to have them in our brain, and we're going to use them as interface to the cloud, to the internet. And when they do that, we actually have a couple of interesting side effects happening. First of all, we have basically a really extended memory, right? Be it in the cloud, that we can instantly tap into the full wisdom on not only Wikipedia, like basically the whole internet, but also maybe inside of our brains. So these nanobots can actually store a lot of information, and they could sit inside of our brain, and just due to this, the pure information being all the time available, we will not forget stuff. We would be able to completely record stuff, like, I don't know, when I'm talking to you guys here, maybe tomorrow you don't really remember everything in detail, but if you would have recorded it on your micro memory inside your brain, you would have the full information still available, right? So that would be digitalized. And so that's one application. And the other thing is, that you can, you can faster process. So means you have a problem in your head, like you want to solve, David want to solve the problem, how do we get to, you know, solve the certain issue that we have a bit later. So then
I will solve that problem. Shanghai does this.
Right, okay. So then he would go and would basically tap into more processing power. So he could basically go and say, like, hey, good people of HeSai, let's all think together about this problem. Because we are already connected anyway, right? My brain is already connected to the internet, and you guys are all connected to the internet, so why not solve this thing together, right? That's kind of like a quite crazy thought. Like, we're going to have a body that doesn't die, and we're going to be able to think together with basically potentially all humans around problems, right? So that's something that's very interesting for our society, because what happens in our society during that time is probably that we have a lot less me and a lot more us, right? The idea of me, my family, me, my problem, me, my thing that we have today already went a lot less over the last years, because we had the internet coming up. We now understand so much better what's the problem of the other people, of the people on the other side of the world. We understand so much better what's even the problem of my neighbor, because he has a WeChat channel that we follow and things like that. So we are already connected a lot more now. But what happens if we really, if I could connect my brain to that guy's brain up there, right? Then I can not only get information from him, I can also get feelings from him. I can get, he bites in a steak, and I can taste that taste, right? So potentially this would really change the way how I feel about him, right? And the way how I feel about all of us. And what will that mean for society, right? So we will be a lot less selfish in the future. We will be a lot more working basically like a beehive, right? Like an ant hill, all pulling on the same strings, kind of like pushing through the bigger picture, the bigger idea. What comes on top of that is that by that time, by the 30s, somewhere mid-30s-ish, according to Ray Kurzweil, in I think 2036 or something is his date, where he says where this exponential graph that we just had is the moment where the AI is going to overtake the human intelligence. So basically, the AI will be more powerful in pretty much everything than the human is, or the human brain is. So what would be nice for us would be to basically team up with the AI. If we already team up all together, more or less in the cloud, as a common conscious, let's say, then why not bring in the AI too? And then we can compute problems even faster and even better, right? So that's what's going to be the next big thing during that time, that we, of course, have the AI helping us controlling our nanobots, stay healthy, organize our planet. By that time, we all don't need to work probably anymore. That's like the needy-greedy problems that we're going to have. But then we also be able to think together with the AI on the future. I guess a lot of people know that from David's office. this is how we at the moment entertain ourselves, right? So whether we go to a cinema, we watch a movie, or we do some VR stuff, or what, we try to kind of like go into another world and be a different character or a different person or have a different experience in through entertainment in another world. Once we have the nanobots in our brain, we can basically download a Hollywood blockbuster and be that, right? I will have the smell of how it is. I will have total hearing like how the situation is. I will feel like the character because it will trigger the same synapses in my brain that it does when I really experience that situation. That's like we all saw the Matrix, right? And we remember in Matrix there's the scene where he cuts off the steak and he bites into the steak and the other guy says like, do you think that is food that you're eating? Do you think that is air that you're breathing, right? So it's only a trigger inside our brain. Only because of our synapses fire in a certain way, we experience something in a certain way. So if we are able to, through nanobots or another technology, to trigger the same points, we could give you any experience that you could ever think of straight into your brain, which is basically that thing X100, right? So that's already pretty freaky, thinking about that. Now, that's body 2.0, right? Body 2.3, or human 3.0, what's that going to be? So that is answers, right? So that is the next stage we're going to have. And that is that we're basically going to replace our body cells with something that at the moment we call formlets. I don't know how we're going to call it in the future, but it's basically units that can where like many of them form a shape. So basically, we would more or less use just the necessary parts of our body, and the rest we would replace with formlets. And that would basically give us, and we already, by that time, don't forget, we are already living in some kind of cyberspace, right? We are already a connected mass of people all together, and I basically can download myself more or less into you, right? Because I'm already connected to you, right? Or into you. So we can also build bodies and then download our conscious into the body or steer that body, right, and feel like the body, if the body has the sensoric that we have in the human body, right? So that is basically what we more or less gonna do with these formats. So we're going to build bodies that are completely able to change. So they can mimic any kind of physical form. Like I can knock on the door and I can be Bruce Willis. And then I can walk through the door and I will be a supermodel. Right? So I can basically form shapeshift myself. At the same time, these formlets also can create any kind of sounds, and all we need to basically mimic any kind of shape. Right? So that's where it also starts to kind of like where the humming noise gets so big that over that kind of time, behind that time, it's very difficult to foresee what happens, right? So when we are with our human body at that point, it's kind of difficult to make out. And this is where Ray Kurzweil says that is when singularity is happening. So now that's almost the end of my talk. What I would like to voice out now is basically two big questions that we can start the discussion with. The first one is basically a critical problem, like a problem that could really happen, is a problem that we actually discussed today already a lot, and that is the problem about the general AI. Like, what happens if an AI would be as powerful as the human brain with a growth curve of an exponential graph? So that means today it's as good as the human brain, but 1 minute later it already grew so much because it's on an exponential graph that it's like 1,000 times better than a human brain, And then just a second later, it's another 1,000 times better. So what happens if we come to that point, right? And there's a lot of people talking about that at the moment. Like one of the most famous ones is Elon Musk, right? We have Stephen Hawking talking about these problems a lot. Elon Musk founded the OpenAI, which is a kind of like a working platform to solve this kind of problems in the way that we try to give the AI a conscious, or like, not a conscious, like an ethics, human ethics, so that the AI would not go havoc. But what happens if the AI goes havoc, right? What would be the scenario that actually happens? And according to Ray Kurzweil, this thing happens between 2029 and 2036. That's the time when the AI will overtake the human brain in intelligence. And what can happen in that moment is kind of like the worst case scenario. I love worst case scenarios. I really read through a lot of them. The worst case scenario that is discussed right now most big time is 2036, we're going to have all these little nanobots in our bodies, right? And we have them in our brain and everywhere, and these nanobots obviously need to be a lot. We need to have a lot of nanobots to actually replace like a lot of cells in our body, deliver a lot of oxygen to our organs and so on. So how do we get a lot of nanobots in our body? The only way is that the nanobots can basically replicate themselves. So we put only like a little bit with a syringe in our body, and then they can replicate and basically crowd our body with it. And that could be something that the AI is going to do. So if the AI, worst case scenario here, right, the AI will go havoc, will basically hijack every single nanobot on Earth, and then what does the AI want? What could be the thing that an AI strives for, right? It's basically computing power. And if we assume that, then the AI will basically try to turn everything that it sees into a silicon chip. And when that happens, then actually what if we go back and see what is silicon made out of, then we basically have carbon. So we basically, the AI will try to find any nanobot in the world and turn any carbon atom into silicon. And when it does that, and carbon actually, for the people who don't know, most living organisms on the world consist out of carbon, even like dead wood and just floor and things like that. We humans and animals and trees and all these things. So basically, there's like the worst case scenario that says it takes between 3 hours and 3 weeks until the whole world, the whole globe is basically turned around into a giant silicon chip. So that is one thing that I would leave out for discussion, because I believe the only way, or one of pretty much the only way in my head, how we can really secure that this is not going to happen, is that we get the nanobots inside our brain before the AI increases the intelligence over the human brain. So that means by the moment the AI will basically be more clever than us, we already melt with the AI. So in that moment, the human brain would basically already be a half AI, half human brain, and then the chances that the AI goes hostile and actually kills the other part, the human being, is not really that high anymore, and probably by that time we also have a digital self somewhere, and we can most likely balance this out. So this is my personal opinion. Right, that's what we talked about there. That's pretty much it. I open this now for discussion. Is there anybody who wants to say something about it? Attack me.
Somehow we already have questions within our company, so people we chatted in our group, so I'll read it out to you.
Can we bring it?
I wish you did that, but I have too many secrets on my phone.
Okay, yeah. Go ahead.
So someone asked this question. So we all are aware of the concept of singularity in the sense that we don't have to die, right? But someone brought up this question that having the chance to die, or having a mechanism that someone has to die, could be a good thing for a species, for a society, or in a business world, having companies to fail would be oftentimes a good thing to help our society as a whole to advance. In a way, modern medicine is against society, right? It prevents ill people from dying, for lack of
it's,
so,
right?
And
it's not only modern medicine, it's basically all growth thinking is mainly based on the fact that we want to extend whatever we do before we die as much as we can.
Correct.
So that's why we always emphasize on speed, on, you know, basically time bundling, right? Doing a lot of things at the same time, and how do we spend time, and so on.
So let me just ask this simple question. Not having to die, is that even necessary or what?
That's a moral question. I believe everybody has to answer by themselves. So there will be, obviously, I mean, this whole talk is very, I think what it makes clear is that the segregation in the humans will start to be very strong, right? Because there's a lot of people who will say, I hate the idea of having nanobots in my body, right? I would rather want to die, or I'd rather, you know, want to lead, you know, a peaceful life, move into the forest and, you know, do my own thing. So, but then there will be the other part of people who say like, no, I believe embracing the technology is the only way how we can push forward. And the segregation between these two parts at the moment is already visible, right? Like somebody who does not have a mobile phone today is already kind of out of this thing, right? Even me, I'm coming to China now just for a visit, I don't have WeChat Pay, I'm already kind of out, right? So this kind of segregation will just go like totally mad in the future. Like we're going to have totally the one side and now we have the other side. And I think the point of making your own decision which child to choose will be a very tricky one, but will be you will need to make that at some point.
Fair. Well, let's open up for the audience to have two questions. Okay.
It's a very interesting question, and it's again one of the ethical questions, right? That I totally didn't go in this talk, because all I wanted to show is like how the technology stream is, and ethically, it's like it is really highly questionable, all of that, right? And we need to really build new set of rules as humans, and we, as you said correctly, we need to build that together with robots, AI, right? So, as we just, I don't know, just a couple of days, I think, I don't know, 5 days ago or something, there was the first robot, who was saying that? You said that, right?
Yeah.
The first robot got
robot mushroom. yeah, which was developed in Hong Kong, but citizenship in Saudi Arabia.
Right. So he actually has a citizenship now, right? So it is considered to be a person of that country. So what does that mean for society, right? I mean, it's just that's a first gag, probably a very good PR for that country and that robot. But yes, we really need to ask that question in the future. Like, how do we regulate that? How do we also regulate, like, it's already difficult enough to regulate only, like, relatively simple things, like, for example, self-driving cars, right? Like, how do we regulate if a car has to make a decision between driving over a child or an old lady, right? In a worst case scenario. So all these kind of things that these regulations will probably be at the moment country bound, but I believe in the moment where we start growing together more as a planet, and we will do that in the moment where the mesh of information gets denser, and we get there most likely sooner or later through the connection of our brains directly, then sooner or later in that moment, we also, when Elon Musk is on the Mars, right, then we're going to have one settlement on the moon, one on the Mars, and then we also got to connect with them. So that the problems are not going to be so much anymore between countries. So hopefully we're going to have a consensus at least throughout the Earth about questions like that. And again, most likely there will be, or hopefully there will be, some kind of democratic solution for that, right? That people can more or less vote for how they like to do that. But then on the other hand, you have the AI who basically also needs to vote on that. Because that supposedly have to have the same rights, right?
Inserts the chips, memory chips into our brains, and you can also like download the upload from like the bottom, like behind our brain maybe. So like you can transfer data, like put humans like computers. So when can we keep the drive safe? Because the core drive, it has everyone's data on that, and humans, and if something happens to the drive, and it would endanger every human beings who that.
Yes, correct. If you ask me, you probably get a different answer than from David, because we had a discussion about that. I believe that the answer for that, at least for a short while, at least for the next 6 to 10 years, will be in a blockchain. I believe that decentralizing data sets is the best way to save data. Safeguard data, and it's also the best way to make data unhackable, right? That what we do in a blockchain is basically we distribute data over like millions of nodes, and if you want to hack it, you don't need to go to one door and hack that one door. You actually basically have to hack all millions of nodes, right? So that is that will be, and right now the blockchain is still very young. It's a young technology. We don't have it fully under control, but there are new ideas on the way, like the DAG chain or the hypergraph, which are new technologies. Let's say blockchain-like technologies, and they would say solve a lot of problems on that end. And I believe that we're gonna do something like that, because that's very short-term thing. I think the time where data is collected on a single point, be it like a single entity, or be it like a company or like a government or something like that, this time sooner or later is over. It's since we now have the technology to advance from that, I believe that sooner or later people will be clever enough to see, like, okay, I generate a lot of data, then I also should have the value of the data, not some company, right?
What is my last question?
I have some thoughts about this renewable energy idea.
That was from
features on Earth, if you look them as a whole, actually life will never end. If you look at all the life forms on Earth again, and evolution is actually the changing of genetic information, which is DNA. Right? And so how did evolution happen? So at first it has some very simple DNA on Earth that randomly they change, and so the life form. And how do we define what's a good mutation, what's a bad mutation? It's not defined by a single creature. Every creature we think it is superior. It doesn't want to die, right? But evolution happens like mutation happen, some are good, some bad, and those bad ones got eliminated, they die, right? So death is a very important aspect of change, because if no one dies, then we cannot differentiate good or bad changes. If we look at human society as a whole, I myself, if there's a method to keep me living forever, I will definitely take it. But as a whole, for the human race as a whole, I think, looking at this time period, I may be viewed as a young and thoughtful person.
Just young.
With a lot of energy, but 200 years later, my mind, my thoughts will definitely not be very suitable. So if I live to that age, I think I will be, rather than a progressive force for humans, I will be hindering the progress of human race. Just think about the historical figures. If they are still here, if they are still the leaders of our society, they will also will not be like the ones today, right? And the bad part about this is that I won't be able to realize this, because I will be restricted by my own flaws. I won't be, most likely 300 years later, I will think I'm superior than the young ones, if there is any young ones at that time. I won't be even be able to realize that I'm actually not the most suitable form of person at that time. So my thought is that it's like every creature is selfish, they want to live forever, but fortunately, every creature needs to die, and they don't decide whether they're going to live, how long they're going to live. But if we really have this genetic method to keep everyone alive, everyone will not be willing to die. Then human society will most likely stop changing. And changing means, like, if there's an alien society, like far away, if they're changing, we stop changing. And one day, maybe millions of years later, we encounter, we could have been much more advanced than this, but then because we stop changing, then when we encounter alien society, then we got totally eliminated at the time.
It's a very interesting thought there, actually, because basically what the idea is here, right, is that by a certain time we already be able to kind of like co-compute with an AI and with everybody on the planet, right? So means like the leader of society that they were talking about, most likely are kind of like a common knowledge. It's like most likely is going to be some kind of entity that is half AI and half of all of us, right? So the idea of having, like, let's say a political leader as we know it right now, or that Mark Zuckerberg owns that one company, it's probably not going to happen, at least during that time, anymore in that area. We don't know what's going to happen with those people who don't enter, right? Who don't enter that field, who basically go back to the forest, let's say, right? But that's a very interesting thought. Like, will we be able to evolve on a different way than evolution? Because basically, instead of evolution, we're going to design the future, right? So when we start designing, do we design the right thing? And what we're doing right now, like what you guys do with the company, for example, is you design something, you fail, you pivot, you redesign, and so on. So that's how you basically have an evolution inside your company. And if we can apply that same kind of concept to, let's say, the new form of society, maybe that will work out. Of course, all of this is theory, but that would be something that where you would say, like, okay, then in that case, if we really be able to transcend to that new way of thinking, to this new way of being, maybe as a whole, we could still survive and we could still be that thing that you actually, in the beginning, you said life, right? So we die, but the thing that ever, that's always going to live is the life itself. And what we're doing now is we replace life with human conscious, or let's say human AI-conscious, and then we apply it for eternity. Very interesting what's going to come out. All right, any other questions, or should we conclude it here and have nightmares tonight?
Yeah, we have other things to worry about.
On hand problem.
Yeah. All right, well, let's thank Marten again for the great talk.
Thank you guys. Thanks for having me here. I wish you guys all the best with your awesome company here. I've been a fan from two years ago.
New York.
And I will keep an eye on what you guys do. Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Well, yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
So I was sitting after the talk a little bit with David, and we reviewed a little bit, and he brought me to the point that it would be nice to share a little bit, some takeaways maybe. So for me, there are basically two takeaways that are important for my life at least. First of all, I try to live healthy, because potentially right now, if you live healthy, you can prolong your life maybe 5-10 years, right? But that doesn't sound so much, but if the difference between the technology has arrived and not arrived, maybe exactly just 5 years or 10 years. So by prolonging your life another 5 or 10 years by living healthy, you potentially get to that age that you, where you actually receive the technology in, let's say, an affordable manner, so that you actually can enjoy the benefits. So people who know me know that I do that basically on a daily basis. Second takeaway is, and that comes back a little bit to the potential hostile AI, where I think, personally think, the only way how we would ever survive a hostile AI would be that we already merged with the AI in some kind of way, in some kind of mutual benefiting way, before the AI overtakes human intelligence. I think that would be something that would be quite important, and we know a lot of big thinkers right now think about the problem. How can we make, how can we give ethics to AI? I personally think that's a very good approach, but the better approach is to basically be, to enable us to be compatible with the AI. So I know it all sounds freaky to, you know, have that little things in your brain that you know, brings you basically into a totally different world, but on the other hand, we throw quite a lot of research
right now and resources into making that AI. So I believe if we don't take care of basically the other side, the human, we will not, but there's a high chance that we actually lose the game in the end. So those are my two takeaways, and I hope this will basically kick off a discussion here. I like to see the comments, and really looking forward to some fruitful discussions. Thanks for listening in, and great that you actually made it all the way here, since that is already pretty much an hour.